So we're doing an in first, right? Hey, it's the announcement guy. I'm up here in the crow's nest with my friends Nathan and Rama. Wanted to give a shout out to our great production department, and also wanted to let you know that we're looking for people to help. You know, if all the world's the stage, I want better lighting. We're looking for a lighting designer, and we're looking for some other people on our production crew. So if you like being part of the action, join us. Here's what's coming up.
Life can get so busy. We can get caught up in going and doing, yet we all need time for being. On Saturday, October 22nd, from 9:30 to 12:30, we will be opening up the Vote Auditorium for a three-hour sacred morning. The lights will be dim, lovely music will play, prayers and meditations will be shared by two ministers, Chris Plim and me, Michelle Medrano. Come for the whole 3 hours or just for a while. It will be a sacred Saturday.
Want to deepen your commitment to your spiritual development and gain a greater sense of belonging in our Mile High community? Our new member class is an excellent way to connect with others while learning about our programs and how they can support you in up-leveling your life in expansive ways. Join our new member class today in person at 11:30 in the community center. No need to register, just show up.
People talk about self-worth. They talk about self-love. But without self-acceptance, you're never getting to self-worth or to self-love. Hi, my name is Rhonda Britton, and I'm so excited to be coming to the Mile High Church to talk about self-acceptance celebration. Because I don't know a human being alive that couldn't use some more self-acceptance. And we are gonna have a good time doing it. I know together, we will become more who we are meant to be. See you November 4th.
Up here in the crow's nest with my friends Nathan and Rama. Love our production department. If you'd like to join us, get a hold of these guys.
We need help. Seriously, I'm hanging on up here.
He's just hanging out for dear life. And we're cleaning the inside of the dome, too.
Have a great week.
Crazy guys, go work for them. They're kind of fun, though. So go work for them. Go talk to them. Hey, I've got a little bit of trivia for you this morning. It's not a baseball fact. Sorry, Barry. But, I mean, you're probably glad I'm not giving a baseball fact. But 11 years ago today, on October 16th, 2011, Mile High Church did their very first live-streamed service. Can you believe that? 11 years we've been doing live streams. So for all of you online, thanks for joining in. Thanks for being a part of it for all of those years, for everyone who's been a part of it. Now's the time that we get to sing together. So if you want to stand and sing, that's great. If you want to remain seated, that's fine. I'll start. You can echo me. Mike's going to lead you in that part. Are we ready? In this world, I am light. I am light. In this world, in this world, this is the place. This is the time. Let it shine. Let it shine. I see the joy.
I see the joy.
I see the joy.
I see the joy.
In this world. In this world, I see the joy.
I see the joy.
I see the joy.
I see the joy.
In this world.
In this world.
In this world. This is the place.
This is the place.
This is the time.
This is the time.
Let it shine. Let it shine. I'm living love every day. I'm living love every day.
I'm living love every day.
I'm living love. Every day.
Spreading peace along the way.
Right time, right place. Living love every day. We are the light. We are the light. In this world, in this world. We are the light. We are the light. In this world, this is the place, this is the time.
Yes, Jennifer Burnett, thank you so much. Great to have you here and our wonderful band. We have Carlos Chavez here playing on sax today. Woo! As well as Stu's here and Mike's here and Bijou are here too. Yay! Wonderful job. Good morning, Mile High Church. Good morning. So good to see you here, whether you're here in our beautiful sanctuary or watching us online. We're delighted to have you with us to celebrate life today. One of the things that I love best about our community and our teaching, I'm going to put this down so I can see you better, Jeff. I can't see you, so hi. Is that we live intentionally. We teach intentional living. We understand that we are co-creators in this universe with the divine source. And when we know this and we're living this out, we can set intentions for our living so that we're co-creating by design rather than by default. And so we invite you, as we start our service together, to set an intention for yourself, to feel what comes up as to what do you intend to get out of today, being here at Mile High Church, or this day in general. Our work is to set the intention, to accept to it, and to allow that life to flow through us such that that intention manifests. Who knows how it'll manifest? Through something I say, through something Jennifer sings, through something that Dr. Patty prays, through something that happens in the lobby or out in the community center or on the way home or right within sight of you. But I know that my microphone can work. That's my intention. Yeah. And so I know that we can do that together. And part of how we set intentions as a community together are to recite and to speak aloud our vision and mission each week. So please join me now. We'll start with our vision. Oneness revealed, a world of love, peace, and abundance for all. And our vision, to serve as a spiritual beacon for personal empowerment and global enlightenment. All those are good intentions. We've set them, and now we're going to step into prayerfulness together. We invite you to sit back, relax, take a deep breath, go within. We're going to sing together, have a few moments of silence, and Dr. Patty will lead us in a beautiful prayer.
Surely the presence of God is in this place. I can feel the mighty power and the grace. I can hear the brush of angel wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of God is in this
I acknowledge this dome of consciousness, and that right where you are, there is that dome of consciousness. It beholds us. It says that everything that I am is of that one mind, that one life, So I recognize a living spirit, and it's sacred, and it has always been, and it always will be. It goes beyond time as we understand time, and it is timeless, and it is present for you. It is the very essence of myself. It radiates in and through all beings. So allow ourselves right now to set that spiritual intention to breathe in that divine light, for it is breathing us, for it is light itself. And so on the path of life, we recognize that we are that seamless union of the divine just by pausing and breathing in and breathing out and being grateful. So I'm grateful for that living spirit, and I'm grateful for this unification. And so I speak these healing words this day, these healing words that come from the brightness of the season of fall, the brightness of the colors, the radiance of the colors, the warmth of the colors, that these colors do just that. They color our lives with a sense of inner peace, with assurance, with goodness, where there's a healing that needs to take place emotionally, mentally, or physically. That light of the divine is there in every cell, shining its light. It's around us. We are wearing a blanket of light, a blanket of light. Oh, I give thanks for this. And I give thanks this day for Mile High Church, for its very rootedness in that spiritual core of divine sacred knowingness, that we live from that center of divine light. It is spiritual, and it's in and through all of life. I bless the beautiful message today of Dr. Michelle Medrano. So powerful, so beautiful. And we take just a moment, and we bless all human beings, no matter what language they speak, what country they live in, what's the color of their skin. We all have red hearts. And so from that place of heart, we bless and we raise this consciousness of the human being to recognizing that spiritual spark. I give thanks for this. So blessedness and healing is abound. And so I just declare this into being with gratitude. And as I declare it into being, I lift it to that place of love and law. And I know that it is done. And so it is. Amen.
In this and every moment, I am safe and all is well. In this and every moment, I am safe and all is well. In this and every moment, I am safe and all is well. In this and every moment, I am safe and all is well. safe and all is well. In this and every moment I am safe and all is well. I am safe and all is well. I am safe and all is well.
Today's inspirational thoughts come from Frederick Buechner. What we hunger for, perhaps more than anything else, is to be known in our full humanness. And yet that is often just what we also fear more than anything else. It is important to tell, at least from time to time, the secret of who we truly are and fully are, even if we tell it only to ourselves. Because otherwise we run the risk of losing track of who we truly and fully are, and little by little come to accept the highly edited version which we put forth in hopes that the world will find it more acceptable than the real thing. It is important to tell our secrets too, because it makes it easier that way to see where we have been in our lives and where we are going. It also makes it easier for other people to tell us a secret or two of their own.
Jennifer Burnett, beautiful. Thank you to you and thank you to our band. That was lovely. Oh. I was so into it. I was like, oh yeah, I got to get up and go do my part now. Before I start, I do want to mention what was in the announcement videos that we're so excited. I'm personally very excited that we have Rhonda Britton coming to be with us on November 4th. Yes, isn't that wonderful? Some of you know her very well. She is the owner of Living Fearless Institute and has a very compelling life story. And I took an online class with her during the pandemic that was all about acceptance, self-acceptance and love. And I agree with her. I don't know very many human beings who have grown up with the world around them saying, you're totally worthy and you're totally acceptable, that we've all struggled where we feel unacceptable. And part of our health and wellness initiative is to accept our bodies, to accept our health, to accept ourselves in every way possible. So I'll be there and so excited on November 4th, and I'm inviting you to join us. You can come be here in our sanctuary with Rhonda and us in person that night, or you can purchase a ticket and watch it online from home, whichever is more comfortable for you, but please don't miss this wonderful, compelling event with her. And I'm going to quote her later and talk a little bit about self-worth. So I am honored to be part of our adventure in faith. We've had a beautiful, amazing committee. Reverend Josh has led them very beautifully, and they have all contributed so powerfully to this year's adventure in faith. And Josh has been speaking and letting us know that our theme this year is leading with light, leading with your inner constellation of truth. And there's some wonderful resources online at our webpage at milehighchurch.org. What you'll find there if you go there, whether you're in a small group or not, the workbook for the small group, totally available. You can print it and download it. All sorts of ways to sign up for daily inspirational messages. And there's also a worksheet that you can work through each day if you like. And I worked through the worksheet as a research and a way to prepare for this talk. And so the talk, I use here are the questions in the worksheet. So the first worksheet is the quality of life I choose to lead with today. And I, of course, chose oneness because my title today is Oneness as Uniqueness. And so I felt very much in resonance. I've been knowing this was my message for a while, and I've been thinking and planning and researching and contemplating oneness for quite a while. So that's my leading quality. And the second question is the quality of light I choose to respond with. And I felt reflection come up. And it has a double meaning. I believe that the light of the universe is shining through each one of us, and we reflect it in who we are, and that every being has access to that light, and they reflect it back. And every time I think about this message, I kept seeing each one of us like a disco ball. And I didn't have a disco ball costume, so I did my best to bling up today as a representation of that light that we are that shines forth from us, because I do like my bling, but I also can feel that it represents that beautiful reflective energy that we're going to talk about. And the third question is about the light of reflection, and I like how this one talks about viewing our life from afar off and looking at the quality we would most like to express. And every time I've done this with the worksheet, I've come back to love. I would like to see my life be a reflection always of love. And the same with the next question, the last question. The light, what light of aspiration or what northern star quality would you like to continue to grow or express into? And again, my answer was love. So that's how we can use the worksheet. I've been using it. It's a wonderful tool for getting in alignment with this theme. But because my title is Oneness as Uniqueness, I'm breaking it down. Firstly, I want to talk about oneness. As a minister, as a spiritual leader, there are lots of things that I feel like if I could prove them to humanity, I could change the course of my living and everyone's living. The quality of life for us would go up. And one of the things that I seek to prove to myself and others in this holy, sacred work that I do is to the proof of oneness. Imagine a world where we all absolutely lived from our oneness with each other. It's a worthy contemplation in and of itself. And today, I've been thinking, well, how could I convince everyone here that we are all one and we can and are already living in oneness? And if we could feel it and live from it and express it, how it would impact our lives. Now, it's interesting to note that spiritual teachers throughout the ages, indeed, spiritual teachers from all of the faith traditions on our planet, especially the major ones, I think live in a place where they're either mystical practitioners of such traditions, mystical Christians, mystical Jews, mystical Muslims, mystical Buddhists, mystical science of minders, or they're fundamentalist. The letter of the law, the rules, what are we doing right, what are we doing wrong? Yeah, even in this teaching, I'm happy to see none of them here today, thank goodness, but the mystical realm, though, is the realm, I think, because spiritual seekers, no matter what tradition, find themselves in an inexplicable place of connectedness to the divine, where we can recognize that we can only use our words to point to it, but that each person has to find their own centeredness in their mystical oneness, and that a huge purpose of faith tradition is to call people back in every way possible to this truth, and that the traditions that are the most alive, that are the most fulfilling to humanity, are ones that do this, even when they confront our perpetual argument for separation, sometimes because we haven't experienced oneness, or sometimes because we want oneness, we just don't want to be one with them over there. But the acceptance of oneness is a full acceptance of connectedness to all things, to all beings, to all life. So religion, spirituality, has made an attempt to call people back to it, and to some degree has been successful, but still many of us exist in a perpetual state of feeling disconnected, separate, alone from our God, from the universe, from each other, when oneness is, I believe, what we live, move, and have our being in. Comedian Dave Barry says it very cutely. He says, the one thing that unites all human beings, regardless of age, gender, religion, economic status, or ethnic background, is that deep down, we all believe that we are above average drivers. That might be it too. Not sure that proves it. So we go from the realm of spirituality to science. It's interesting to note that Ernest Holmes, the founder of this tradition, was alive in the heyday of the work of Albert Einstein, when there was much talk going on about Einstein's theories of relativity and how Einstein was proving that at the molecular level, everything and everyone is made of the same energy, which specifies itself in the form of that thing or that person or that expression. And there are some urban legends, some urban myths that indicate that Holmes and Einstein actually were at a party and talked together. I cannot prove that, but I like it a lot. Holmes mentions Einstein in his writings and mentions Einstein's and his theories. And it appears to me, and as I watch the evolution of Holmes' writing, that Einstein's theories cemented Holmes' experience, mystical experience, and intellectual belief in the oneness that connects all of life. And yet, reading his words has impacted me, but I don't know that every person who reads Holmes' words feel that sense of oneness, but science continues to reveal to us the connectedness of all life. Indeed, this very month, the Nobel Peace Prize was given in physics to these three gentlemen, Alan Aspect, John Clauser, and Anton Zeilinger. They won it in achievements for landmark achievements in quantum mechanics, the study of the behavior of particles and atoms. It's long been theorized and
and some experiments have shown that the connection of particles at a vast distance. But these three gentlemen proved recently, absolutely, that entanglement, it's called entanglement, a mind-boggling phenomenon when two particles behave as one, even though they're at a vast distance to one another. Albert Einstein once described the phenomenon as spooky. But the three physicists show that quantum entanglement is real, and their discovery is going to support us in allowing, they say, the transfer of information across huge distances to be more profound for us. It's opening up all sorts of things. So science itself is beginning to accept and literally prove the connectedness of all life. Still, we tend to move and act and behave at times, and most of the time, as though we're separate. I think because we're attuned to it, even though many of us have probably had those mystical experiences of one. I know I have. I've had a few experiences in my life that I can close my eyes and think back on, and I can even feel that feeling of being merged into the one, that feeling of, I know who I am, but I feel so connected. I can't feel the boundaries of my body anymore or my beingness anymore. I am immersed in the oneness of life itself and then find myself back in the awareness of my beingness. I think we're more attuned to separation than we are our oneness. So I started to think, if I were going to prove today or attempt to prove our oneness, could I make a list? And at first it started out to be kind of silly and funny, almost like one of those Jeff Foxworthy lists, like, you know you're a redneck if kind of things. He wrote the book and does comedy routines. One of my favorites is, you know you're a redneck if you spend 40 hours a week at Walmart and you don't even work there, that kind of thing. He's got a whole bunch of them that are funny. And I started thinking, well, you know you're experiencing oneness if. And then my list got very serious very quickly. So here it is. Here's my list. That today, I want to say, if you've ever experienced any of this, whether it be a mystical experience of oneness or that sense of oneness, here are some other things that happen to us often on a daily basis that I think reveal to us the oneness we live, move, and have our being in. You know you've experienced oneness if you ever knew someone was going to call right before they called. Yeah, some of you have done that, I can tell, right? You think of somebody and the phone rings. You know you're experiencing oneness if you're driving in your car and you start to turn or change lanes, but you sense before you even see them the person who's there. You know that you might be experiencing oneness if you can encounter someone and have an immediate sense of what they're feeling. And I know many of you felt this. You come to church, you sit down next to someone you don't even know, and you can feel some of what they're feeling. That's oneness. That's connectedness. You know you're experiencing oneness if you watch some art expression of painting or dancing or acting or music performance, and there's a connectedness that is so compelling that it compels you to have goosebumps or be filled with tears of joy. You're not performing it, but you're so connected to the one that is. You're sensing. And it cannot be in the now moment. It could be something that happened years ago. This week, our music director, Tom Litch, sent a video via text to Josh and me of Louis Armstrong singing his song about a beautiful world. And I played it and I felt myself get full of chills and tears. I wasn't in his presence, but I'm watching a video and I'm connected. So oneness is beyond time or space. You know that you're experiencing oneness if you have loved in such a way that your connection to another human being is profound. You can not only feel them, sense them, you can just feel your connection. Sometimes with a child, a grandchild, a special child in our life that we love so much, a person who's a good friend that we can feel the connection we have with them no matter how far apart we are, a beloved whom we love and adore. This is oneness. But what it takes, doesn't it, in this world, is for us to recognize these things, to own them, to claim them. My mother was telling me recently that she was inviting people she knew to have synchronicity journals. What I'd like to suggest to us today in the practice and the honoring and celebration of oneness is for us to have a oneness journal, to spend every day looking for signs of our connectedness and our oneness. It's who we are. It's our essence. It's what unites us with all of creation. And it is what we know to be true, and when we allow ourselves into it, we experience a greater sense of connectedness to all life, to all beings. We experience that connectedness to all possibilities, because in that place of recognizing oneness, if some healing or some experience has happened anywhere, it's available everywhere. And I am in the everywhere that exists as oneness. Therefore, I am in resonance with the good that is expressing on this planet, whether it's happening over there or over here, it doesn't matter, because there is no separation. And so I'm connected. I can access any information, anything that I want to access from an energetic standpoint to create in my life. Oneness creates belonging, a sense of belonging for those of us who feel so often afraid when we have no one else around us. It's impossible for us to ever be alone because we are always connected to the everything that exists in all time and space at all times. We can't ever be disconnected from it. It's impossible. So that story we tell ourselves falls away if we've struggled with loneliness or a sense of disconnect. When we practice and live from and cultivate our oneness, we begin to feel this more often, more profoundly. And nature mirrors this for us. If we look closely at nature, why would nature ever say there can only be one flower? Nature loves the oneness, the connectedness, and the diversity, and that's the truth of us too. Oneness as uniqueness. We are one and diverse. So there isn't just one kind of human. There isn't just one kind of tree. There isn't just one kind of bird or one kind of insect or one kind of flower. There's a multiple number of expressions in these things, in this realm. And it's the same for us. We all have DNA, but each one of us has a unique code of DNA. It's almost as if that which created us such that we could feel connected always, yet we could be who we came to be. Both and. Not either or. Both and. But the challenge of this for us humans and for our human mind is sometimes we get trapped in thinking that to be one means that everybody has to be like me. That oneness is sameness. I talked about this a few months ago, and Ernest Holmes says very clearly to us, the perception of unity sees through all differences to one universal sameness, yet unity does not mean uniformity. We do not all have to be alike, think alike, or act alike, but the world is learning we must all act in union. The infinite one manifests in infinite variations, each rooted in the one, but each divinely unique in its own right. Good, bad, high, low, across, above, and beneath are all one to the infinite mind. So the beautiful North Star of this is to live and cultivate a life of oneness while honoring and accepting our uniqueness. It's a pretty basic challenge, though, for most human beings that I know that comes down to our worthiness issues is that most of us were raised in this Western world where our culture, the people around us, the authorities around us, the norms, socio norms, the economic norms, say, we want you to grow up, and it's more important that you do and be like we think you should do and be, rather than doing and being like you think you should do and be. And most human beings I know spent a good majority of their time unlocking and healing from the past so that eventually there can come a day when they can stand in the full glory of their beingness and wear their shiny vest and shine to the light to the world and be their unique self and express themselves in a powerful, confident, loving way, while at the same time not ever faulting anyone else who chooses to do the same in their world. To celebrate and honor oneness and uniqueness, right? That's the opportunity before us. That's the work before us. It always has been, and it always shall be. And I think where we struggle sometimes is that we fight so hard. We felt that urge as a child or maybe a teenager or even today. I just want to be normal. And I love the meme that says, normal is the setting on the washing machine. It does not allow us to shine. If we can heal from that need to be normal and set it aside and make what's more important to me for myself and everyone else is that I feel that connectedness of my oneness and I just want to be me. I just want to express as my unique self. And to practice that in relationships, the things we talked about in the readings, the song Jennifer sang, being honest, finding a relationship where we commit ourselves to saying, I'm gonna be me. I'm gonna be all that I am. Now, I understand that sometimes in relationships and in settings, certain ways that I'm being me don't work for other people. And I can work in loving kindness with my partner and my kids and my friends to heal our relationship so that it can be a full expression of our unique selves. But I've learned now that any relationship, any job, any friend, any condition that says I can only be there if I be the way they need me to be all the time, that's not the friend for me, it's not the job for me, it's not the relationship for me. And that's okay, that I can step away from it and stand back so that I can have the courage to be connected to the allness that is and find the true north of my own uniqueness to express in the world. As singer-songwriter Karen Drucker puts it, she has a song about being your big, bright, brilliant beam of radiant light shining. I like that song. Try to say it 3 times fast. Go right ahead. I challenge you. We shine by speaking our truth. We shine by allowing our light to share our gifts and talents and not hiding them under a bushel anymore. We shine by being ourselves and following our rhythm of life. We shine by understanding that when we choose to shine and be who we are, not everyone's gonna be thrilled about it, and that's okay. In our workbook for the Adventure in Faith work, Carl Rogers shared the concept that what is most personal is most universal. This statement speaks to that interesting relationship between oneness and uniqueness. The idea being, when you are your most unique, it can actually resonate in a way that inspires a sense of oneness and connection in someone else. Isn't that the most lovely feeling? To be my one self and my unique self and have people around me who love me as I am. Isn't that what we yearn for? We have to cultivate it. We have to claim it. We have to take the risks that allow us to shine that way. And one way we also have to cultivate it is we have to accept when other people want to do that too. I was driving the other day, and I was looking in the rearview mirror, and I looked behind me, and there was a gentleman driving his car, and he had metal in his face in places that I was like, how in the heck did he do that? And I found myself starting to get a little bit, like, judgy about it, and then I suddenly went, well, it's his face, it's not my face. I'm not going to put metal on my nose, but if he wants to do that, and that makes him happy, I'm good. And it was just a little example, but it's that in big ways in our world, isn't it? We're afraid of other people being their unique selves. But when we cultivate it in ourselves and we cultivate it in others and we cherish our oneness and we find ways to feel at one, even when we look out at people who we don't feel one with, we can say, I don't agree with them, I don't align with what they're doing or what they're talking about. But in our Beyond Limits class, there's this exercise we challenge the students and we just give it to them for a week, but it's a good daily practice to look out at those people. Deeply, we are one. You're thinking of them right now, aren't you? It's holy work. It's holy work. Deeply, we are one, yes. But it's the most sacred practice to cultivate that, to live like that, and to walk through our lives owning our own worth, accepting and expressing ourselves. Beloved Rhonda says, if you value yourself, you understand that you are a gift to anyone you meet. Hi, my name is Michelle, and I'm a great gift to you today. You know, it's like that kind of arrogance, but it's kind of there. It's the knowingness that when we come together, when we look at each other, when we speak to each other, when we hug each other, there's a gift in every interaction that we share with one another. We are gifts to each other, and we own that, and we live from that. And so, as we look out into our world, our own world, the opportunity in front of us this week is the embrace of this concept, this both and, oneness as uniqueness, the dance of the two together. I tend to like the shows that depict the future, the possibilities of the future, like Star Trek, Star Wars. By the way, another urban legend is that there's a belief and there's a picture of George Lucas with the Science of Mind on his shelf, that he got the idea of the Force from us. But anyway, I digress. I love those shows that depict the possible future for us. And Ken and I were recently watching The Orville, which is produced, directed, and written by Seth MacFarlane. And so at first I thought it was going to be some crass science fiction thing, but it's really quite meaningful. And now it's on Hulu. It's called New Horizons. And in their third season, the closing show, they are a group of people traveling the universe, exploring other people, cultures and planets, and doing holy work and doing the kind of things you'd expect in Star Trek. And they kind of have the prime directive like they did in the original Star Trek. We don't interfere. But they have this incident where somehow a off-world girl from a planet that's not quite as evolved as theirs ends up on their ship. And the first officer is trying to educate her because she wants to stay with the Orville crew. And she's telling them about their worldview. And she tells them, the young lady, that what shifted their worldview forever was the invention of those machines where they could just walk up to it and say, triple shot latte. See, it's not working quite yet. I'm waiting. I'm so excited when that happens. But they can do that and the latte appears. And when they finally got that they could replicate any food they needed, any items they needed, they could let go of capitalism and money and they could just express themselves because they no longer had to fight for stuff. They no longer had to worry for their future, for their well-being at the most basic level. It started to be handled. And when that occurred from them, when they relaxed into that and their nervous system got used to it, they evolved into, well, what's next? How are we going to express ourselves now that everyone has everything they need? And so the first officer explains that the next form of currency became expressing yourself uniquely. She said, we went from thinking that people who had the most money were wealthy to people who express themselves in our society for the good of their own self, the expression of their own gifts, and for the good of the whole are the wealthiest of all. And it changed so much for them. And it touched me to imagine living in that world. And in a way, if I'm practicing oneness, all that I need is available to me. It's not quite the replicating machine they have, but it's the closest we've got. There's security. There's a sense of peace and well-being and comfort in living like that. And it allows me to be in full expression of who I am. And that's the challenge that we're posing this week in our adventure in faith. And it is an adventure in faith. It takes faith in the oneness that connects us all, and it takes faith in the truth of who we are. I'll close with a quote from Ernest Holmes. You are an eternal being now on the path of endless unfoldment. Never less, but always more of yourself. Life is not static. It is forever dynamic, forever creating, something done and finished, but something alive, awake and aware. There is something within you that sings the song of eternity. Listen to it. Listen to it. Let us pray. I invite our practitioner prayer partners to stand with me as we pray this prayer. We stand in this consciousness of oneness. And I invite us just to breathe and to remember together the moments that we felt that connection. Maybe it was a transcendent moment of prayerfulness or meditation, a transcendent moment out in nature. Maybe it was a moment of absolute connection to another human being. I remember holding my beautiful infant son for the very first time. Oh, I'm feeling so connected. We remember and we collect together in consciousness now these moments of absolute connectedness, oneness, to remind ourselves of our true nature, to attune ourselves to our true nature. This is why we pray. This is why we meditate. This is why we spend time in nature. This is why we come together in spiritual experience. This is why we love arts. This is why we love communing with each other. We get to be reminded of our connection. And we cherish those times, those moments when we have let ourselves express ourselves fully and completely, where we've shared our heart and felt love and acceptance, where we've danced our dance, let our freak flag fly, and just been our unique self with joy and abandon. And we recognize that in those moments, we most honor God, we most honor the universe, when we allow our unique beingness to be fully expressed. So it is in this prayerful moment that I accept and affirm more and more of this light shining forth through us, from us, knowing that as we shine our light, we invite all others to shine their light. We are one. We make a difference. Our light makes a difference, and we let it. In love and gratitude for this truth, I simply release these words into the law. I know that as it has been spoken, it is done. We let go, we let be, and so it is. Amen.
I am healed. I am whole. I surrendered to it all. When I trust and let go, then I know that all is well. All is well. in this and every moment I am safe and all is well. In this and every moment I am safe and all is well. I am safe and all is well.
Ah, thank you, Jennifer. This is the time in our service where we invite you to consider expressing your oneness through sharing abundance. What I know about giving is that it connects us to the life that lives within us, the abundant nature within us, and it allows us to have a physical expression of acceptance of this truth. And so in a minute, our ushers are going to pass baskets. We have containers in the lobby. Those of you watching online, I offer a special invitation. It's very easy, I know, when we're watching online to stay disconnected and stay over there in your little safe haven. And this one way today that you can contribute can allow you to feel the connection to your own abundant nature, as well as the abundance that supports and lives as each one of us. And when we get notes in the mail, people send in tithes and offerings. There's one contributor who always sends the most beautiful love notes, and she sent one this past week, and I want to share it. Her name is Lynn. And she said to us, "Beloved Mile High, bless this gift and use it to perpetuate prosperity, healing, and loving kindness in the universe. Thank you for your many blessings, and so it is. Love, Lynn." Beautiful, beautiful. Thank you, Lynn, for your contributions and for this lovely note that I've kept on my desk all week. Because that is who we are. That is what we do. That is how we live, move, and have our being. So as we give today, let's prepare to do that by saying our affirmation out loud. Please say with me, divine love, as me, blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, and all that I circulate. And so it is.
Achieve it, that's why I believe in you.
Yeah, Jennifer Burnett and the Mile High All-Stars right there. Thank you, Carlos. Bijou, Mike, and Stu. All right. It's a party, isn't it? Okay, so if you're here for the first time, we're open every Sunday. And hope that you'll come back and see us again. There's information out in the lobby. There's a welcome center out in the lobby. So if you'd like to know more about us, check that out. And we also have a new member class today in person right here afterwards. So another opportunity to learn more about us. And yeah, welcome. Just know you're welcome here. And also our practitioners are coming forward right now. They're available for a brief prayer right after the service. So if you'd like to connect, they're available for that. And one more thing is that the pumpkin truck is going to be here at noon today. So a lot of people thinking, man, I'd like to lift a few pumpkins. This is an opportunity for that, and they'll be right out over there in the corner. All right? Thank you for being here.
Josh says it's the greatest workout you'll ever get. So, come on down. Hey, we want you to know about a couple things happening this week. We're very excited to be having our Sacred Saturday next Saturday from 9:30 to 12:30 over in the Vote. If you want to come and have some sacred time of oneness, you can come for just a little bit. You can come the whole 3 hours, whatever works for you. The labyrinth will be open. It'll be a really beautiful sacred experience. Wednesday night, we got a guy named Dr. Roger. Yeah, he's going to be doing our Wednesday night insight. So you can tune in online and hear some wonderful wisdom from Dr. Roger Teal. And I've got this guy standing right next to me. You know him, Reverend Simon Shadowlight, right? Yeah. So Simon has been with our staff for, well, since 2011, we think. He worked on the staff. He went to ministerial school here, became a minister around 2014, joined our ministerial team as an assistant minister, became an associate minister. And this last year, we've made a change to his status. You haven't seen him around as much because he's doing some work with us that's more invisible right now to you. But we're very happy to say that he's supporting our education program as we're creating a platform for self-paced classes that you could get online and take a class anytime you want from us. 3 a.m., 3 in the afternoon, whatever. Simon has made huge contributions to our community, to our ministry, and this is just one other step he's taking. And we just want you to know what he's up to. So thank you very much, Simon. Thank you, thank you. And now we invite you to stand as we do the benediction and peace song. We go forth in love and light and wholeness to celebrate the oneness and the diversity that is the living truth of who and what we are. We give thanks for it. We live it out. Thank you, life. And so it is.